Beacon Press Audio presents American Furies, Crime, Punishment, and Vengeance in the Age of Mass Imprisonment by Sasha Abramsky. This audiobook is narrated by the author. Published by Beacon Press Audio, 2018.
Introduction. From Out of Tartarus. Moundsville, West Virginia, is a sleepy little town deep in the heart of Appalachia, a 90-minute drive south of Pittsburgh. The otherwise drab town center is dominated by the crumbling but still formidable visage of the old state penitentiary. Since the mid-1990s, when a new prison was built, the town has hosted an annual mock prison riot run by the Federal Office of Law Enforcement Technology Commercialization and actively supported by West Virginia's congressional representatives in the dank 19th century penitentiary. Spanning several spring days inside the abandoned cell blocks, common areas, and yard, the mock riot has become a fixture on the social calendar of corrections aficionados from around the world. "Freeze! Don't move!" Enforcement Technology Group sales rep Aaron Dexter barks into an electronic gadget perched in front of him on the central lawn of the old prison in April 2005. Immediately, the public address system translates the commands into Arabic, the harsh, staccato voice amplified as it reverberates off the prison's massive, turreted stone walls. Clad in a t-shirt and gray slacks, the slightly bald Dexter keeps feeding in commands, and the PA system keeps broadcasting them across the yard in different languages. The hundreds of onlookers, mainly prison employees, who have driven or flown in from around the country, many shivering in the damp early spring of Appalachia, applaud. The command translation machines were developed, Dexter informs me, with funding from DARPA, the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, the shadowy Defense Department organization that has over the decades provided seed money for everything from the internet to state-of-the-art biometric devices to bioweapons detection technology. They were originally designed to control captured insurgents in Iraq and Afghanistan, as well as terrorist suspects in Guantanamo Bay. In all possibility, the brutalized prisoners who turned up in photographs from Abu Ghraib in 2004, some hooded and with electric wires attached to parts of their body, others being set upon by attack dogs, others bruised and bloodied from beatings, and still others naked and under duress performing various sexual acts, had at times, during their confinement, heard Arabic orders hurled at them through these sorts of machines. Now, however, as the distinctions between American overseas military operations and domestic control policies for the country's burgeoning prison and jail population become more amorphous, translation systems are being marketed as must-have tools for high-security institutions inside the United States. For a mere $1,200, a prison administrator can buy the device pre-programmed to simultaneously translate approximately 1,000 commands into Arabic, Spanish, and Russian, with additional languages as optional add-ons. Inside the exhibition hall, a blue and yellow prefab metal building erected in a corner of the yard, dozens of new technologies are on display, the salesmen and women aggressively touting their products' benefits and demonstrating how their widgets work. Like quack medicine sellers of a bygone age, they promise that their wares will deliver wonderful, transformative results. There's a table with a picture of a fully armored guard, his eyes covered in thick goggles, pointing a gun straight at the observer. "Tactical and Survival Specialties, Inc. Equipment your life can depend on," reads the sign. There's the red man training gear featuring a dummy decked out from head to toe in red armor plates, made of some indescribably strong, plastic-looking material, its face covered in a mesh guard. Another dummy is dressed in what looks like an updated version of medieval chainmail, the face protected by a plexiglass mask, the hands covered in thick gloves, a cross between the Terminator and a Knight of Camelot. Then there's the unmanned miniature spy plane, marketed for use above prison yards. "We're partnering with a lot of companies in Israel, where the technology is now very commonplace," the sales rep explains matter-of-factly. "Correctional facilities really like this equipment, but," he continues somewhat mournfully, "they're considered the bastard child of law enforcement, and they don't have the funding to procure this." Another marketer talks about the possibilities of the Verichip, a microchip designed to be injected into humans with a syringe so that the controlling agency, be it the prison, parole, or probation, can monitor their whereabouts. Alas, this particular invention is not on display in the exhibit hall. Someone else hawks tiny black Lecter Mark II tactical robots that roll around on little tank treads, carrying spy and camera equipment into corners that guards cannot easily access. Standing on one of the busiest aisles in the hall, a grey-bearded inventor fast-tracked into the United States from Britain by the Department of Homeland Security explains the portable system his company has developed for taking biometric readings from people and then feeding them, in real time, into databases to see whether the individuals on lists are potential bad guys. It is being designed to augment airport security systems, to protect vulnerable bridges and tunnels, even, he tells me with a touch of glee, to help Halliburton defend Iraq's oil pipelines. If cameras detect suspicious activity along the pipeline, he explains, the system will feed the suspect's biometric data into a database to see whether it matches those of known insurgents, whose data has presumably been taken in one or another prisoner processing camp somewhere in post-Saddam Iraq. If it does, the information will be transmitted to a drone carrying Hellfire missiles that can take aim at the troublemakers before they have time to blow up the pipeline. One day, the inventor hopes, these devices will be standard law enforcement equipment across the United States. Traffic police might carry them. Prison guards might use them to screen visitors. Already, he tells me, his company is preparing to crank out tens of thousands of these gadgets in the coming months. My favourites, however, are the bone conductor headsets, aptly named radio ears, that convert vibrations of the skull, generated when a person speaks, into voice-like sounds that can be transmitted even in the noisiest of situations. The sort of inherently improbable and, yes, seductive creation periodically unveiled in a James Bond movie. Of course, in addition to the sexy technology showcases, there are more mundane exhibits, the various forms of stun gun weapons, the new, super-lightweight batons, the acoustic grenades that disorient inmates with bursts of unbearable noise, the various dispensers of tear gas, pepper spray, and mace. There's the Numb John rubber dummy being pummeled into oblivion by the demonstrator of a vicious-looking rapid containment baton. There's even a fold-up chemical toilet, complete with pop-up privacy tent, for those moments during a prison standoff when you've just got to go. In its time, West Virginia State Penitentiary was intended to awe the populace with its impenetrable facade and its portcullis entrance, from the beams of which were hung capital defendants in the period before the introduction of the electric chair. One man, the rope was too long and it was a very painful hanging, explains the woman who registers me for the mock riot event, and in one man, his head come off, which wasn't fun. The prison was intended as an architectural presence suggesting the invincibility of the state and the insignificance of those serving out their sentences inside. Until 1995, prisoners lived in these dank, lung disease-inducing cell blocks with their chicken wire fences and tomb-like cells, 5 by 7 feet, with ceilings barely high enough to allow a man to stand up and virtually no natural light. Now that West Virginia houses its miscreants in newer, more sanitary facilities, the penitentiary is at once a tourist destination for those looking for glimpses of the bad old days and a venue for large correctional gatherings. Every spring, 1,500 people descend on Moundsville, named for the large Native American earthen mounds dotted around the region. Its small, clapboard houses built to house workers during the heyday of American industrialism. To attend the event, swap stories about the latest technology, watch teams of correctional officers enact simulated riots, and observe the latest control techniques developed by state, federal, and privately run prisons in response to unruly inmates. Replete with large dinner buffets, fist-pumping speeches, opportunities to show off buzz cuts, muscles, and physical prowess, there are speed competitions in such categories as hostage rescue, and an abundance of machismo energy, even in the quieter moments, the mock riot is one of the correctional world's undisputed annual highlights. It is, claims the narrator of the promotional video created out of footage from the 2004 mock riot, one of the most spectacular events known to the corrections community. As he talks, film rolls of prisoners being taken down in a cartoonish, almost computer game-like way, of SWAT teams and of armored officers wielding stun guns.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.